then in 69, there wasn't just the first album, there was the second album as well. And what was 7-8 months apart, something like that?
Yeah, I know that when I look at the whole of 1969, because we play in San Francisco in the January of that 69, I look at it and I think, how did we do it?
But how did you even manage to sit down and be like, right, today we've got to record the second album?
Because
your schedule.
Because I had things written for the second album. We kicked it off over here in. We had things, to kick off in Olympic, where we'd done the first album, which is at Barnes here in London. And a whole lot of love was done, of which that sort of foundation of it on this new releases. And What Is and What Should Never Be, which is another one that appears on the... On this,
that is
a slightly different version.
But that is that
isn't that a great way to start a whole of an album anyway, though? Because you've got the two contrasts, you've got the sort of, you know, attack,
absolutely,
and you've got the whole sensitivity. And then there were things that we got together doing some recording, and you know, somebody might add a bit on there, you know, like Jonesy might add a bit on something, and then there was a. You know, he'd get a writing credit or whatever on some of the things, like the Heartbreaker, I think he's
right.
But anyway, you know, that's how it went. And we were recording while we were on the road. The idea appealed to me of doing that, because on the first album, we'd played the stuff live and then gone in and recorded, and that had really worked. But to actually be able to do this while you're on the road and maybe go into some really famous studios like Sun Records or Chess. Well, we didn't go to those studios, but other studios we did go to. So it was just really good, because each of those studios sounded different, and again, it made for the whole sonic aspect of...
And the dynamism, of Zeppelin II. It has that kind of urgency of four guys literally blazing a trail across a continent.
Yeah, thanks. No, it really did. It was really, well, we recorded certain things over in America, and we came back again because of our touring schedule. And Thank You and Living, Love and Made were recorded in Wilsdon, and then back to America again. And then the more overdubs were going on, and then the mixing, I did the mixing with Eddie Kramer in New York. Eddie Kramer had been working on a few of the things all the way through, from the recording the tracks and the overdubs, but not everything. But he did do all the mixing at the end, and I was there with him doing that.
Spending all this time going back, looking through the stuff for not just the remasters, but for the companion disc as well. Not only is it a massive job, emotionally it's quite a big thing to do, because you're looking at not only your best stuff, but just some of the best music in the world. When you listen to it, when you're sitting there going through the bootlegs and the tapes, and how does it make you feel? That's what I want to know.
It's just so wonderful. I mean, I'm saying this as someone who's in the band, but I can't preach to the converted, because I know people who understand. But you can hear Led Zeppelin maybe, but if you listen to it, and if you listen to it intently, and you understand how the performances of these musicians are, and then collectively what it is, it's almost going at counterpoint, and yet there's this sort of swing and drive to it. Or there's this sensitivity. I mean, there's just so many colours, there's so many emotions that are there within the music that are conveyed. Because each track, I think, has its own character, and its own, let alone its own sonic quality, but its own character. It's really, I mean, that's the way that it was meant to be. That's how I saw it. Each each thing being like that. And that's why I was so keen to record in different studios to get, you know, knowing that we used ambience and that, getting the different spatial concept of it. So they're all little details, actually. It's not major, but the fact is it all went to make up the sum of the parts. I knew I had a pretty good handle on what there was, what other things there were. I knew there were alternate mixes to various things, or mixes in progress, or alternate versions like the Since I've Been Loving You. I knew they were there. It was just a question of sourcing them, making sure. And yeah, there was a lot to listen to, because you might have, you know, you might have maybe 10, 12 boxes to say Since I've Been Loving You. Doesn't necessarily mean that it's the one that you're really looking for. So that's it. Everything had to be listened to, copious notes made, and then you start to sort of assemble them relative to how many versions you've got of each song and what one really is quite radically different to them, to the one that everybody knows. And there you go. That's how it's a long process, but boy, it's really, you know, and it's just going to be a real treat for the fans. And yeah, listening to it, it just reestablishes all the time. I don't need to reestablish or boast about how brilliant the band is, because everybody knows. I mean, we're here talking about it all these years later, because everybody knows how substantial it was.
One thing that always fascinated me, and I think I've heard you say before, is that there's a blueprint on the first album for everything you wanted to achieve with the band. And lots of people say, you know, oh, by the time you get to Led Zeppelin III, oh, wow, they've, you know, it's a radically different sound, much more folky, blah, blah, blah. You've gone to Wales. But to me, you can hear that in Zeppelin I anyway.
Yeah.
I mean, I suppose maybe at the time it was radically different.
Well, what Zeppelin I has, it has so many, there are so many colours and ideas on it that people hadn't done before. That they hadn't thought of it that way. For example, something like Baby, I'm Gonna Leave You, where you've got the whole aspect of this sort of fragile, it's like a folk fingerstyle guitar. I know what it is, but it's the way that it gets employed with the overdubs that come into it, and then the sort of like those sort of staccato flamenco sections. The whole orchestration of it that's going through until it gets to that sort of more the middle section, which has got more sort of groove to it, with everybody, the full ensemble are in on it. I know nobody had approached anything like that. I know I knew that they hadn't. Communication breakdowns was like a punk sort of, you know, punk sort of driven thing. Black Mountain's side is like an acoustic with tabla drums, so it's even alluding even there to sort of, you know, I don't even want to use the term world music, but, you know, fusion. And then you've got the bow on say Dazed and Confused and How Many More Times. All of this will give you, you can see why I wanted to, I knew I'd had all of the sort of apprenticeship, if you like, of working in the studio as a studio musician, with the discipline of that, and taking on board and studying recording techniques and what the various effects units would do, studio effects units, tape echo, compressors, all of this stuff I'd taken on board. I'd been sort of saddled in with the Yardbirds, which is a terrible shame that we were sort of held down by this whole sort of singles market, that we had, you know, we had to do these sort of singles. Although the music that we were doing outside of that in live concerts, which is so totally different, that I knew what I wanted to do with this band. If I could get the right personnel, and I knew that I wanted to produce it, because there were certain things. If you had a producer in, you started doing the bow, they go, oh, I don't know about that. That sounds too raspy. That's hurting my ears. Can't we just cut that section out? Or can you just play some regular guitar? No, I knew what I wanted to do. I knew that certain things that could be sort of certainly in the area of the guitar that were going to be pretty well. It was just going to show a whole sort of kaleidoscope of different ideas and different techniques, different approaches. And I didn't want anything in the way of that. I knew what I wanted to do, and I knew how to go about it.